morning, everyone. So welcome to the day three of the DHIS2 Analytics Tools Academy. So we have around 28 participants logged in as of now. So we have a few more to join. So before moving on to today's agenda, let me remind you the basics. So you have to mark your attendance for day three. And in case any of you have not given us the feedback for the day two, please go ahead and complete that feedback because we take the feedback seriously. And based on the feedback, we will be doing slight modifications for today's sessions as well. Right, so just to recap what we have done so far. So on day one, we have been introducing you to what we'll be covering during the DHIS2 Analytic Tools Academy. And then we did a demonstration of the analytic tools available and how to use them in the practical scenario. And then followed by that, yesterday, that was on the day two, what we did was to recap on DHIS2 design concepts and how these design concepts can affect the analysis that you are going to produce. So we finished the day two with an exercise. It's not a graded exercise, but it's a group exercise that we wanted all of you to interact and do it, because from today onwards, we'll be having graded group exercises where all the group members will be assigned a common mark. It'll be a group mark, and there should be group submissions. But one comment that all the facilitators had about yesterday's group activities is that we saw in some of the groups that all the group members were not interacting that much and were not kind of contributing to the exercise, which is not a good practice. So I encourage all of you to interact with each other when you are doing the group exercise, because one reason for us to have these group exercises so that you can build up networking, because you can understand that in your group, it's usually not a mix of group members from one country, right? So we have tried our best to arrange groups in such a way that you have a good mix of different participants from different regions in the world joining. So it's a great opportunity for net. So we encourage you to have group exercises. And today we are also going to try out the Zoom breakout rooms for group exercises, so that you can have some audio connectivity as well, as opposed to the chat messages that is available in Slack. Right. So let us start the day with a few remaining questions from yesterday's exercises. I think we only attempted three of them. So let us move on to the question number four of yesterday's group exercise. So are you all there with me? Can you all open up the question number four from yesterday's group exercise? Right. So are there any volunteers who would like to give the answer to the question number four? Any volunteers? Or should I just randomly pick a group? Because I want all of you to interact, because only when you talk that we'll be able to know what you are thinking and like whether you are going on the correct path. So we encourage you to volunteer and present. Any volunteers for question number four?
Yeah, number four, group set is a facility type. It includes groups as a MCHP, CHP, and other types. Am I here? Hello?
Yeah. Yes, we can hear your answer. So let me just read out the question so that others are also oriented on what we are discussing. So the question number four is, during the demo, we discussed that organization units can be divided into groups. Okay. So we demonstrate public-private group as well as the ownership group set.
Yes.
So given the following organization units, so we have a set of organization units that are available. What is another group set that you can think of for these organization units. So one organization unit group set that they have already defined is the ownership group set. So other than group set, what would be the one that you can recommend? So
answer is a group set can be a facility type. That facility type groups are MCHP group, CHP group, and other types, which is not included in the MCHP and CHP. Hello.
Right. Thank you very much for that answer, Deepal. Let us also see, because it's a kind of a tricky thing about organization unit groups and group set. So shall we try to get few other answers from other groups as well? Anybody else have different answers to what Deepal mentioned? Any other groups?
Pramod, from our group.
Yes. Yes, please. Can you share your presentation?
Okay. Hold on. Let me do that.
So you are representing group one.
Group one. So our groups is more or less the same, but the group set is type, as he said, but the groups are hospitals and health centers. That's what we say. The CHC seems health centers and the CHV seems hospitals. So we group them in two.
Right. All right. Yes. That also we will accept. Any other answers from other groups? So we have two answers from Deepal and Erib. And any other answers which are different to these two?
Hello.
Yes, Anuradha. Yes.
Yeah. Can we differentiate this as urban and rural?
Urban and rural, other than ownership.
Yeah.
All right. Yes, that is also possible. So the thing is this right now. So just by looking at this list of organization units, the way to look at the answer is like now we have a set of organization units which they have grouped. So the groups that they currently have is public organization units and private organization units, the two groups. And those two groups, they are putting into a group set named as ownership. So that is one classification. So we have to find an answer where this can be classified based on another criteria. So it could be anything, right? So as of now, the only one that is taken is private public, the ownership. So, okay. So likewise, now the couple of answers that have come up so far. So Anuradha mentioned whether it is urban, rural. So urban, rural, Anuradha, the organization unit groups. So what would be the group set in that sense? I mean, like, is it again the urban, rural? I mean, just a name. Do you have any other name or just put urban dash rural or something like that? And did you give a separate name for the group set or just urban rural?
Just urban rural.
Urban rural, yeah, that's fine. I mean, like, as long as it makes sense to all the users who are there in accessing the system, that's fine. Yeah. So that answer we can take, provided that all the organization units that you have there could be categorized into these groups. If that is possible, yes, that answer we will take. And of course, we can take. So basically, like, if you look at the list of organization units, you can see some are kind of health centers which are providing maternal and child health care, and some public health services or community health services, whereas we also see some hospitals. So if you feel, I mean, this answer does not have a very specific correct answer. It all depends on on the requirement of your country. So for example, if you feel, okay, in my country, I want to, when I make some analysis, it is very important for me to at a glance see what are the statistics coming from hospitals and what are the statistics coming from community health services. So if that is a concern in my country, it would make very much sense to group them as hospitals and community health services facilities, something like that. So both these answers, all the answers that have been mentioned can be correct answers. So what I want you all is to understand how to analyze this question. So this question is about, you have a list of organization units and they expect you, when you have a list of organization units in your country, to group them properly, because then the analysis would be much more structured. So what you need to understand is, if you have a set of organization unit, how are you going to classify it? So one organization unit can be a member of multiple groups. Okay, so that also you have to realize, because now, for example, we have this private and public same organization unit would be a member of public, private, that so basically ownership organization unit group set, as well as say if you're going to put urban ruler, even in that group set, it can be a member. So that you have to realize. Okay, any queries on this? Right, if no.
Yes, from one. So the basically, as you mentioned, all answers are correct, but the how you group them just depend on how you want to analyze those data. That's as simple as that. Yes.
Right. Right. So let us move on to the next question. So I'm seeing like a few of the groups are very active. I'm expecting more answers from other groups as well. Otherwise, in graded exercises, this may become a problem. All right. So let us move on to the question number 5. In DHIS2 WHO demo instance, access the HIV monthly data set. In order to do this, select the data entry app, select any facility, and select HIV monthly data set. And you can use any month. Identify 3 indicators that you could potentially create using data elements within this data set. Note that you can combine with this data from HIV annual data set that is collected at the district level. The data set has an estimate of the people living with HIV. All right. So this is about HIV data set and what indicators you can create using this HIV data set. So any volunteers for this answer?
Yeah, Hasita here.
Yes, Hasita.
Group 9.
Yes. Yeah, if you can share your brass slide, yeah. That would also be
yeah,
fine.
Yeah, sure.
Right. I'm seeing your. Yes. Okay. We can see your.
Screen. Is it fairly visible, or shall I?
Yes. 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 That's fine.
Okay. Now. In the this WHO aggregate data entry form, now we can see this couple of types of sections, 2 sections actually. So at a glance, I see this HIV test performed and HIV test indicator, like HIV test positivity rate, in where the HIV test positive and the HIV test performed taken as the denominator, and we can multiply it by 100 to get a percentage. And I had some trouble with this HIV annually, which is said that it is collected at district level, but let's see. There is something called HIV monthly. I think it doesn't give any population data. Is that the population data?
Yeah, were you able to access the population data data set which they mentioned? So, Hello, can you hear me?
I couldn't see any HIV annual data set anyway, assuming that it collects some population data, like something like total population with the people living with HIV, and in a likely scenario we can go for something like a percentage of people who are having HRT. So so the numerator can be the people who are currently the total population. And similarly, we can go for something like percentage of widely suppressed population, and as the denominator, we can have the total population. Could you hear me? I just got a message that my internet connection is unstable.
Yeah, we can hear you. Sorry. Was it there?
Yeah, that's fine.
So the concept here is that you need to know, like, when you have a couple of data sets, right? And these data sets may be collecting information based on different frequencies. So some may be monthly data sets, and few of them, especially the population data, may be coming on an annual basis. So when that happens, what happens is when you're creating an indicator, it may be an annual indicator, and you have to know, like, which data elements that you'll be obtaining to make this indicator, and what will be the factor. Factor is like, I mean, you multiply it by 1,000 or 100, likewise. So that you have to know. And the thing is, like, you may also understand that the numerator and denominator for a particular indicator may not come from the same data sets. So this is the generic idea that we want you all to when you are creating an indicator. So yes, as long as you know this much about indicators, that is fine. Yeah. Okay. Right. So because we are running short of time, shall we move on to the last question, which is to produce the following output. What two concepts am I combining? What do I need to ensure upon initial configuration to achieve this output? So we have a table where the row columns are male and female, and then the rows coming from hospital, health center, and dispensary. And the data, the table is for RDT malaria positives, right? So what are the two concepts that you all are combining? Any volunteers for this one?
Hello? Hello?
Yes, Deepal, please proceed.
Yeah, I think we use data disaggregation based on the sex as a one concept. Other one is the organization grouping based on the hospital, health center, and dispensary. So I'm from group 5. Hello? Hello? Hello?
Yes, yeah, continue. We can see. We can hear you, yeah.
Yeah, I think there's a two concepts. One is at the data disaggregation level, it's based on the sex, male and female. That's a one concept. Other one is a organization grouping. It's the concept. According to that, there is a two groups, hospital, health center, and dispensary. That is answer.
Okay, fine. Now we have one data element here, and it is disaggregated in two dimensions. Yeah, as you mentioned, one is male and female, so that is gender, and the other thing is the hospital or the institution or the facility, hospital, health center, and dispensary. So by disaggregating that data element in that two dimensions, so you will end up with this six data elements. So the answer is correct here. Yeah, Pramod, shall we move to next one?
Yeah, so that's all for the questions. Any other queries that you all are having? If not, we can start with today's topics.
Hello.
Okay then. Sorry, Shalika, yeah.
Regarding question number 4, the answer can't be the MCHP, like, can't be categorized like that.
Well, you can do that. So that is, like, I mean, only thing, what would be then the group set? What is the group set name that you are going to give for this one? I mean, so ideally, if you can't put a proper name, then only you should be, like, you know, listing out all the name, all the constituents of the groups as the name of the group set. If not, if you have a proper generic term that you can use as a group set, you should use that, because otherwise the groups can change. Right, because it's a concept that you should ideally add as a group set name. So is it like, again, like the hospital facility type, something that you are meaning by the, I mean, like it's also going to be hospital facility type that you're going to add as a group set. Isn't that so?
Okay.
No, I mean, like, I'm just asking. So yeah. So basically what you did was you are mentioning the groups that you are going to have, to which all these organization units are allocated, right? So the only query I have is, what is the term that you are going to use as group set name? So if you can
think of your term, we can use as group set name. Yes.
Yeah.
But
yeah. So
we can categorize into because there are so many CHCs, and we can categorize like that way, isn't it?
Sure, you can categorize, but then you have to also think about the group set name that you're going to give. So that's what I was wondering, like maybe the group set name is also going to be type of health facility. Is it?
Yeah, one more thing, Pramod. So all of you, all of them have tried to include all the org units into groups and group sets. So that's good, not nothing wrong. But the fact is, you don't have to include each and every organization unit to group and group set. A group set may have groups where only a part of the whole organization units are members of that groups and group set. So you can omit one. So easily you can group some like MCHP, CHC, like, and you can omit if you want the final one to just only one hospital mission. So likewise, in a group set, it is not necessarily have to have all the organization units included.
Right. So I see Derip has raised his hand. Do you have any question?
Oh, that was for to present the answers for question number 4.
All right. Okay. Thank you. Okay. All right. So I think we can head with today's sessions now. So today we will be discussing about validation rules. So the first half will be done by Neha, and the second half will be by Priyanka. So let me invite now Neha to proceed with the session.
Good morning, Pramod. I'm here. I'll share my screen. So, good morning to all of the participants. I welcome you to the third day of the academy. Hope the last 2 days have been a good learning experience for all of you. So, today we will, as told by Pramod, we will learn about the validation rules. So validation rules basically comes under the data quality. So we will learn about the data quality, and under data quality, many parameters are there, but we will discuss about the concept of validation rules in the RHRS2. So there are some parameters for data quality. First would be completeness and timeliness of data. It means how correct the data is, and has the data been entered on time, right? So the second one would be internal consistency of reported data. By internal consistency, the data which has been entered should be consistent within a certain period of time within that health facility. And there is some external consistency. The data should make some external consistency as well. That is that it has to be in agreement with other sources data like surveys, etc. The data should be consistent with external data sources like survey data. For example, if you talk about immunization coverage, it can be further compared with surveys like district level household surveys or national family health surveys. So the data should be consistent with that data as well, though those are external ones. Then the data should be consistent according to the population estimates. So for example, an eligible couple population, if we have data for an eligible couple population, the data entered for pregnancy and family planning indicators the population data can measure the coverage of the indicators, which further can impact the birth rate. So the data quality, I mean, DHS2 allows for these various aspects of data quality that we can check. In some work, additional work may, in some cases, some additional work may be required in order to ensure available data, which is necessary for comparison. Though we can say that DHS2 cannot be a substitute for every possible data quality type, but it can enhance the quality of data that is being entered substantially by using the built-in features to review the data prior to analysis, interpretation, dissemination, and feedback. So as we have already discussed, there are some parameters for data quality, completeness, one being them. So completeness basically reports to understand how complete the data is in the system. Data for all the elements, for all reporting organization units should have been submitted. For the user, whenever enters the data in a particular data set, needs to click the complete button at the end of the data entry format. The second principle is timeliness. Now, what do we mean by timeliness? So timeliness reports to understand if the data being received late or on time, whether the user has entered the data on time or late. All data from all reporting organization units should be submitted at some appointed time. So as we all know, that data set, in a particular, suppose, for example, if there is a data set of maternal health that needs to be entered by 5th of every month. So if a user enters after 5th of that month, that will be a delayed reporting. But if the user has entered the data before the 5th of, by the 5th of that month, it will be a timely reporting. So these can, a data set generally has an expiry date, which we can enter in a data set option. So basically timeliness and completeness are generally generated by the system itself. So however, there can be unique cases which can be handled differently. For example, if the facilities are closed from month to month, then of course timeliness and completeness will not be considered. Then we talk about consistency. Of course, data consistency is required. So for consistency of data, to maintain the consistency of the data, validation rules which compare actual values against other data elements, threshold survey, or other sources. So basically, what is a validation rule? Here we'll learn about the concept of validation rule now. So validation rule is verified that the data a user has entered meets a particular standard before user saves the data. Before finalizing the data, a user needs to validate the data properly. There are some validation rules which needs to be checked before the user finalizes the data, because as we all know, incorrect or invalidated data leads to a poor decision making, which further can impact our health services or health scenarios. So basically, now what is a validation rule? So validation rule is based on an expression which defines a relationship between a number of data elements. So expression, which a validation rule consists of an expression which contains a left side value, an operator, and a right side value. So here the validation rule is malaria cases treated. This is the left side. Is less than equal to, this is an operator. Suspected malaria cases, this is the right side. So malaria cases treated should be less than equal to suspected malaria cases. So basically, the validation rule will tell that what is true, what should be true. It will not tell you that rotavirus 2 administered should be greater than rotavirus 2 outlier. If there is some outlier, it will not tell you that. It is someone between the number of data elements. It is based on the expression which defines the relationship between a number of data elements. So this is how the validation rule works. The expression forms a condition which should assert that certain logical criteria is met. So when we think about validation rules, we can actually consider different examples. The first type are validation rules that check logical. That check logical rules. These type of rules should generally be true and therefore absolute. In that, values should always pass the test. Logical rules can often use data already within DHIS2 unless you are performing triangulation with data of some kind that does not already exist in DHIS2. In those cases, you will need to import that data into the system so that logical rules can run correctly. By this, we mean if logical rules will work when the data is in the DHIS2 itself. But if you want to do some data triangulation from any other data sources, then you have to first import that data in DHIS2 and then do the validation checks. So here, as discussed, malaria cases treated should be less than or equal to suspected malaria cases. This is a logical rule. The second will be rules using a threshold. This would be covered by in the later part, the threshold, the rules which use threshold. So basically the concept of validation will be the user should validate his data through run validation after completing the data entry. At the entry point itself, we should make sure that user should validate its data so that the finalized data, the data which has been finalized, should be correct and validated. So that a proper data analysis or any other decision that would impact on the data should be correct. So these type of rules can incorporate data from aggregate data entry, event capture, tracker capture. So we are not covering event and tracker capture here. We are only talking about aggregate data entry. So you could collect data from tracker, doses administered by individual, compared just an aggregate threshold that you have calculated for a particular time period. You are able to evaluate if these rules are violated by either viewing them in data entry. You can do them in data entry itself, at the entry point itself, having them run on an automatical schedule which you define. There is a scheduler which you can define, then the automatic scheduler will run and then you get the system will tell you that some of the rules have been validated and then they have been cross validation, triggering them via validation rule analysis. We have an app through data quality app through which we can run the validation rule analysis. I hope I'm clear till now. Fine. Now we will see how the validation rule works in the data entry. So here we will log in under the demo app. Here we'll go to data entry. So here the data has already been entered. So now if you want to check whether any validation rules has been failed, so we can simply click on this button. Hope everyone is seeing this. Run validation button over here. We'll click on this. And it says IPV. This is a validation rule which has been configured in the DHIS2. We will tell you how to configure a validation tool later. So this is basically IPV doses given should be less than total used and wasted. So the left hand side has value of 274 and the right side has value of 160, right? So it should be basically the left side should be less than or equal to 160. It should have been 150 or 160. So it has thrown an error. The data entry screen has the following validation error. So we need to correct. So after the user enters the data, he or she should click on this run validation so that the entry point, at the entry point itself, the data is validated properly. So if we'll see here in the data entry, you see there is IPV doses which has been given to less than 1 year. 271 children has been given for less than 1 year and greater than 1 year, three children. So total is 274. Whereas for that particular month, if we see down, the vaccination of the stock of the vaccination IPV, the 60 was starting balance, received was 130, 30 was an ending balance, I mean that, and 160 has been used. So 160 has been used, but 274 has been administered with the dose, with the IPV dose. So this obviously is a validation error. So the user here can check easily that the data is not entered properly for IPV doses. So he needs to correct the data. He or she can recheck from wherever from the data source is entering the data. He, she should call a concerned health worker for the correct data so that he can check the data here. So first point is this only. So in the data entry app itself, we are checking. We are validating our data, right? Now this can be checked in, suppose if the user does not have time or he or she has forgot. So he should make some practice before finalizing the data for checking the validation rule analysis in data quality app. From here, he will search on data quality. Click on this. There's a run validation rule analysis. Validation rule analysis over here. You click on run validation. So we will select any of the district, post to SCAD district only. So we can enter. Suppose we need to enter from the check for 3-4 months. So we select this, we select immunization validation rules, and then we validate, click on validate. So it will show us the number of validation errors. But this is organization unit is Panther, period is January 20, or importance would be medium. So here left side is 911 and should be less than 896. Details will be shown here. If you want to see details, what all the details are, you can click on this details button and you can show. I mean, this type of validation rule analysis can also be done by the user. Mainly, this type of validation rule analysis from the data quality app is run, it's helpful and beneficial for the data managers. So suppose if the user has not entered, or if the data manager wants to show that the data which has come from the facility level is correct and validated, that data manager cannot go to each and every data entry form and click on run validation. She needs some consolidated report kind of thing. So then that data manager can use this data quality app for running the validation rule analysis. So from here, we can download as PDF also, download as XLS also, download as CSV also. So he can just download in XLS or PDF, then he can mail across to its facilities to recheck the data. So this is the one way of doing it. I mean, this is the second way of doing it. First was at the entry point itself by checking in the data entry after completing it and after doing the run validation check. So I hope this has been understood by now. So now,
sorry, there is a question which says, what does importance mean here?
At the importance, yes, we will let you know. We'll, when we'll, now we are starting with the creating a validation rule. I'll tell you about the importance. So these validation rules basically are configured in the system, already configured in system. Now, how will we configure a validation rule based on our based on the data entry or the data elements which we capture? So first we'll go to data entry. Firstly, we need to check what kind of validation rule one. I mean, it should be a logical one, as we talked. So suppose if here we can see, so now we'll create a validation rule. I'll show you how we should create a validation rule. Firstly, we need to we need to identify what kind of validation rules we can create. It should have a logical value. So here we can check this, like we have malaria cases, malaria positive RDT, the cases which have been positive by RDT, rapid diagnostic test. So we can check the positive cases. And then we have different species of malaria available, that is Plasmodium falciparum, Plasmodium vivax, Plasmodium mixed RDT. So basically these positive cases which have come out positive from through RDT should be equal to all these malaria species, right? I mean, if a male of between 0 to 4 years, 275 males between 0 to 4 years have been tested positive to RDT. So from what species it has been? I mean, this 275 should be disaggregated among these. I mean, it should be equal to this. I mean, how many tests were done for falciparum? How many tests were done through vivax? How many tests were done from mixed? So you need to identify basically what kind of validation rules we need to create. After identifying, what we have to do is we have to go and maintain this. Here we have validation. Now we'll create a validation. For creating a validation rule, we have to click on add. So we will give a name to a validation rule. We'll give a justified name, suppose positive RDT should be equal to sum of malaria species. Right? So just to be sure that it has been created by me, I'll prefix with my first three letters, initials. So this would be a name. We can give a short name also, though it is not mandatory. Then if you want to give any kind of code to it, then you can give a code. If there are some kind of codes which needs to be given to the validation rules, we can give it. Then we do need to put a description over here. The description can tell you that the positive RDT cases should be equal to Plasmodium falciparum RDT plus Plasmodium vivax RDT plus mixed slash other This can be a description. So we can give any instruction also if we want to give any instruction. So this same can be the instruction as description and instruction can be same. So medium, there are importance, high, medium and low. High would be, high validation rule can be like if there are some indicators which need high importance, like a maternal death or a cholera outbreak or any fever cases. Like these. So we can give importance to these kind of validation rules is high. So even malaria can also be a high. I mean, we can give the importance to them, to this validation rules as high, because then we have malaria mortality also. So I hope you've understood now by what do you mean high, medium and low. High is the validation rules which are of high importance. For example, any adverse event after immunization, if a child has some adverse event, those validation rules can be given high importance. Malaria outbreak, cholera, any disease outbreak can be of high importance. Maternal death, infant death can also be of high importance. Medium will be your medium ones, like normal data entry. Low will be the low importance in validation rules. So I'll keep it the medium. Monthly will be a period type. That particular data elements we enter the data either monthly or yearly or bi-weekly, whatever. So we'll select, now we'll see the left side expression. So left side would, what was positive RDT cases, right? So now we'll click on left side. So we can search. So here basically we have three things over here, missing value strategy. It is skip if any value is missing. If any value is missing in this particular element, then this validation will be skipped. So it is not a good practice. So skip if all values are missing. If all values are in this particular data element is missing, then also you have to skip it or never skip. So by default, we generally keep it at never skip because we want to check, we want to validate our data. So from here, you'll search your data elements. So over here, it was positive RDT cases. So we can search through RDT. So this malaria cases tested or malaria cases positive. So positive RDT. So we will double click on, we have the disaggregations over here also, but then this, you need to check this. So we'll double click. The UID of the data element will be shown in this box. And then you have to put in the description as well. Yes, anyone is saying something? So the description can be either you can type in by yourself or else you can simply copy and paste over here. So that is easy, or else you can type by yourself, malaria causes positive RDT. You click on save. So this was your left side expression, which comes here as malaria cases positive RDT. Now we have an operator over here. We have different operators like equal to, where what we are going to use here is equal to. Then we have not equal to. Of course, when do both the elements, we want that these two elements should not be equal. So we'll select not equal to, then greater than. If the first left hand side should be greater than the right hand side, then we'll select greater than. Then greater than or equal to, as the name suggests, should be greater than or equal to. Then less than, if the right left hand side should be less than the right hand side or less than equal to. Then we have compulsory pair and exclusive pair. By compulsory pair and exclusive pair, I mean other operators are self-understandable, but for the compulsory pair and exclusive pair, compulsory is when both the data elements are necessary to enter. There should be data in both side elements, left side and right hand side. So compulsory pair is that. So we can check that compulsory pair. Example of compulsory pair is like we can have stockout days, for example. We have stockout days, for example, the user needs to, the compulsory pair basically, so it makes a compulsory, for example, if we are asking about drug stockout days, then it makes a compulsory pair if the user has selected as yes. Then he must also enter how many days the stock was not available. So basically, if the value has been reported against A, then B should also have a value. That makes a compulsory pair over here. In exclusive pair basically allows you to assert that if any value exists on the left side, left hand side, then there should be no values on the right hand side or vice versa. So basically we can say that if A has a value, then B can't have. For example, in this case, an example can be a facility can either report stockouts or stock available. If he's reporting stockouts, then he cannot enter stock, any kind of stock which is available in that particular period. It can't report data for both the sides. So I hope a compulsory pair and exclusive pair are clear, because the other ones are understandable. So equal to, over here we'll select equal to.
I'm sorry if I'm interrupting you. So just a little prompt here. Any of the validation rules that you'll be making in your system are not really meant to always say that the data entered is incorrect. It is actually a prompt to the user to just go back and check whether it is that way or not. So there can be times when a validation violation is being shown, but that is actually a real picture. Let's say ideally it was supposed to be that your ANC registration and your deliveries, let's say, would be having a validation rule there. So let's say there is an approximate value that you expect generally in a given month with respect to your ANC registration, but it might not always be. It might sometimes get raised above that. It often happens in terms of immunization, I believe. So in immunization as a domain, it often happens that we expect that it is only that catchment area which we are delivering in from a given health center. But there are some individuals who keep migrating from one place to another. And that is why it might be possible that there are like 10 children who are due for vaccination, but the actual vaccinations delivered have been 12. So that is not actually a violation as such, but the system will take it like that and will prompt the user to go back and just check. So it doesn't mean that it is incorrect. So just... thank you. Over to you, Neha.
Thank you, Vanu. Thank you so much. So here the operator is equal to, so we'll select equal to. Now we'll select the right hand side expression. So it was plus Plasmodium falciparum for RDT run by Plasmodium falciparum. So this looks to be double click, so the ID will appear here. Then we'll click on the plus sign. You can click on the plus sign also. You can type the plus sign from your keyboard as well. Then we have Plasmodium vivax RDT. Yeah. You can type vivax also, or you can search from here also, from another next arrow. Then we'll double click here, right, we'll appear here, then plus, click on the plus sign again, then we have mixed species. Mixed other malaria species. So here they will show the name of the data elements that has been assigned to this validation rules. Suppose if by mistake there is no hashtag in front of this element, you say expression is not well formed. So you need to check that the expression should be well formed. So by default, if you select the element from here, it will be prefixed with a hash, but you need to reassure. So this, now you can just enter the description over here. So description is getting a bit larger, so you can simply use some short forms as well, like this. So this is how it is. So you click on save. When you click on save, the right hand expression is also saved over here. You can see here. Then you can click on this save button. The validation rule will be saved. We can see from here, we have this validation rule that has been created over here. Now, if you want to edit this validation rule, there's three colon, this action. You can simply click on this. If you want to edit, you can click on the edit and you can edit your validation rule. Now, if you want to clone, you can clone it. Cloning, by cloning we mean like you, if you want to use the same data, use the same kind of equal to kind of validation rule, you can clone and make another validation rule. Sharing settings, then if you want to delete, you can delete it. Then there's show details. Show details will show you the details like description of when it was created and last updated and the ID and its API. Right. These are the options that is available. So once we have created validation rule over here, so I will tell you how to create a validation rule group. Just like the organization unit group, we have validation rule group. So we will create a validation rule group, and suppose if we are creating, since it was for malaria, so we can. I'll prefix my name. Malaria, yes. So, any code you want to give, any description you want to give, so you can give. From here, all the listed validation, all the created configured validation rules will be here, available here. And from here, you have to select this. You can search also from here, or you can select from the list available. So we click over here, we'll click on this arrow, or you can double click also. That can also be done. Then you save. So this is a group that is been created over here for Malaya IoT test, right? Validation notification will be taken up by Mr. Priyanka in the second half of the day. Now we'll this kind of validation rule has been done. So I have been created. Hope you now understand. We'll do the exercise also. How we'll create the validation rules.
Sorry for interrupting, Neha. Can you be a little slow? I think we are getting some feedback for that.
Okay. So should I repeat the this thing? I mean, how to create a validation rule? Should I repeat it or should I go ahead?
Maybe just in brief, if you could do that.
Okay, sure. So we all know we have to. From maintenance, we'll go here. Maintenance, we'll click on validation. Then we have to click on the plus sign. Then we'll give a particular justifiable name, according to the name of the validation rule, short name. Any code, any description, any kind of instruction, medium, high, low, or medium, important, sorry. Then we retype monthly, then we will select the left side expression. From here, we'll search the data element, whatever data element you want to assign on the left hand side. So we'll search by its name, like we have done for the malaria RDP cases. So we'll just double click it, and the ID will appear here. You need to enter the description and then you have to click on the save button. I'll not recreate it again. So then we will select the operator from here, equal to, not equal to, greater than or equal to, less than or equal to, compulsory pair or exclusive pair. So these are the different operators that are available in the system. Then we'll assign the data elements on the right side expression, similarly by searching from here itself, by putting some keyword of the data element, plus medium,
the keyword. So from here, we'll double click it like this. And this the data element ID, UID will appear here. We'll click on save, and this will be saved. Then later on, to save the overall validation rule, we'll click on this save button. To assign in any of the validation rule group, we have basically validation rule group we create for the program specific validation rule group. Suppose I am an immunization program officer, so I don't need to check other validation rules. So for that, I'll create my own group for immunization. A maternal health program officer will check the validation rule which have been violated for maternal health group only. So validation rule group basically consists of the same type of a particular program validation. Okay. Here you want to give a group validation group name, then code, then the description is there. Then you can search from here, or you can just type your validation rule. So it will show, and then you have to click on save. So this, you just click and then select, I move it to the other box, and then you have to click on save. So this validation, what we have created is, we will check through the, from the data quality app. This is the data quality app. So validation analysis, if I'm program officer, I do the validation rule analysis from here. So we'll select minimal region or any district we want to select. We'll select our organization unit. We'll select term period. Any time period from here, we'll select mine. This. So I'll click on validate button. So it will show me the validations. So this is all the validation rule that has been violated in the birth district and in the given in this time period, January, February, March. So we can download it as PDF, we can download it as XLS, we can download it as CSV. So here is the validation rule. As we all know, the first entry, the first checkpoint for any validation to check the validation rule violation is your data entry. The user needs to, I mean, the user should make a good practice to check through the run validation option if the data has been validated. As mentioned by Varun, this doesn't tell that the data is wrong. There can be possibilities which the data is like that only. So, but then of course it tells you, it can enhance your data quality through these type of, through this validation checks. So now we should start the exercise. So we all have the, so what we all need to do is we have to perform this assignment and we have to create in this WHO demo instance itself. In Moodle, I think we have the assignment.
Okay. Yes.
Yes, Priyanka.
Yes, Neha. Yeah, you are referring to the ungraded assignment assessment, isn't it? Okay, let me show.
Okay. for the part one.
Yeah. Right. Let me share the screen. Right. Right, I think you now can see the Moodle. Okay, here, so we are in day three. Under the day three, you get this book, Data Quality Part 1, Validation Rules Review. So just click the book, then it will open. So you have the content on the right side, table of contents. So under this content, down here, the last one, it is ungraded practice validation rules review. So it is ungraded practice validation rules review. Click that. Then you will get this part one of ungraded practice, which is validation rule review ungraded assessment assignment, and you have three questions, and try to answer these three questions. So those are not very complicated ones, so very basics. And how it will happen is, now it is almost 11:15 Sri Lanka time. And it will take nearly to 15 to 20 minutes, and with plus 5 minute break. So we can break up for say 20 minutes. And after 20 minutes, we can start with the rest of the session. And at the end of the session of this validation rule, you will be having a graded assignment. So that assignment will carry marks for the final total. So today, so there's a deadline. Actually, the deadline will be 10 a.m. Sri Lanka time tomorrow. So before deadline, each group, this would be a group exercise. I mean, this is not this, but what we are giving in at the end will be a graded exercise, and that should be submitted through our learning management system. Then only you can earn your marks. So this is going to be an ungraded one, what you can see on the screen, and this is available in our LMS. So please take your 5 minute break plus 15 minutes work time, and it is 15 minutes past 11 here, and the 35-40 minutes past 11, we'll resume the session for the second part. Okay, now it's the time to practice. So this is your practice ungraded session. Okay. Thank you very much, and hope to meet you all at 11:35.
Is this a group session? Is it a group exercise or?
This is ungraded practice. Of course, this is an ungraded practice. So yeah, you can use groups for this. So for this ungraded practice, or you can even practice individually. So it doesn't matter. Yeah, Pramod. Come on. Yeah, Pramod, yeah.
Yes, so there was a comment from most of you, not most, but a few of you yesterday, that when you were doing this group exercises, using Slack channels, sometimes, I mean, even though it is good, you were missing this audio communication part. So one option we have is we can create breakout rooms in Zoom. So if that is the case, now we can in fact enable the breakout rooms in Zoom. So created. Yeah, so just give me a couple of seconds. Right, I have received few feedback about this using the breakout rooms. So what we will do is for the final exercise, that is the graded one, we will use breakout rooms. So for the ungraded one, we will just do it as how we did it yesterday, just by using Slack. So the assignment that you are having at the end of the day, which will be graded, for that one, we will enable the Zoom breakout room so that you can call other participants. I mean, you can have audio communication between the group members. So for now, I think we can proceed with the ungraded exercise as how we did yesterday. Any other queries? Please use our Slack support channel. If you have any queries, please ask on that and our team of facilitators will reply them. Thank you. I think you can have a short break. Followed by that, you can practice the ungraded exercise.